the kingdom within, the quest for inner spiritual transformation. This will be lesson number 4 in our continuing series of Bible lessons looking at the Sermon on the Mount, Matthew chapter 5. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost, living God, we give this lesson unto you to the everlasting praise of Jesus Christ, the eternal Son of God, and for his kingdom we pray daily, even so come Lord Jesus quickly. Amen. The kingdom within. In our series of lessons, beloved, we've been looking at the Sermon on the Mount. Almost 2,000 years ago, a young man, age 30, appeared out of Galilee. No one beyond his own immediate family really knew much about Jesus. He appeared on the scene in history, pretty much unknown to all the people of his native land. He had been out of the country a lot. When Jesus went to the mountain to preach the Sermon on the Mount, he introduced truth that had never been heard before in the history of the world. At the end of the sermon, the Bible tells us in Matthew chapter 7 that the people were astonished when they heard this sermon. They marveled. They were astonished. They were literally amazed to hear the truth that Jesus spoke. This has been called the single greatest sermon ever preached in the history of the world. And I feel really, really out of place trying to even interpret this sermon, much less preach about it. We're on Beatitude number 3 in Matthew 5. Beatitude number 3. Many years before Jesus preached this sermon, there was a prophet in the Old Testament by the name of Jeremiah who had made a promise to Israel through the power of the Holy Spirit that, behold, the days will come, saith the Lord God, that I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel, with the house of Judah. And it will not be like the first covenant that he made when he called them out of Egypt, Jeremiah 31, 31 through 34. But the promise was that a whole new covenant would come forward in due season at some point in time. The New Testament in your Bible is the record of what we call the New Covenant. New Testament, the word testament is covenant. The Sermon on the Mount initiated the New Covenant. When Jesus died at Calvary on the eve of the Passover, when he passed the symbols of his body and his blood to his disciples, he announced to them, "This is the blood of the new covenant, which is shed for many." You can read that in your Bible in Matthew 26, verse 28. "This is the new covenant, which I shed for you and for many." Jesus initiated the new covenant, and the Sermon on the Mount was the prelude to everything that the new covenant was to incorporate. Pentecost confirmed the initial down payment escrow of the Holy Spirit, which was necessary to bring the new covenant into God's children. So today, you and I are of course, totally dependent upon the Holy Spirit to confirm the Sermon on the Mount in our hearts. The only way that the Beatitudes will ever become part of your life is through the power of the Holy Spirit. Without the Holy Spirit, we don't stand a chance of being able to master the Beatitudes. They are revolutionary, they are transforming, and they will change the way you live your life if you have a heart to believe God. If The Holy Spirit is working in your heart today, and I trust He is, then you may have arrived here this morning to let Jesus and the third beatitude alter the way you live your life. Let's go now to the Sermon on the Mount, Matthew chapter 5, verse number 5. Blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. Can we all say that together? Blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. Now, a paraphrase way to say this is, happy are those who learn to be humble, for they shall inherit the earth. The Greek root word for meek can also be translated as humility or gentleness. They're synonyms. Happy are those who learn to exercise meekness, humility, or gentleness, the promise being they shall inherit the earth. Now, church, on the onset, we need to desperately dismiss the idea that meekness means weakness, or that somehow humility and gentleness is to be equated with a person who is weak and ready to be a doormat for other people to walk on. Meekness is strength under control. Humility is someone who has the ability to bring the strength of who they are under control. In this particular beatitude, it will be wise for us all to remember that the word meekness or humility is always a good way of saying that a person who practices this character quality is a strong Christian who has their emotions under control. Do you know such a person? If you do, praise God. It requires spiritual strength to be a meek person. Humility requires personal strength of character. It's not easy to be humble. When you think of meekness, humility, or gentleness, it might help us all to remember this illustration. Take your imagination and go out west to a pack of wild horses. And you see a wild stallion running with his mane flaying in the air. You see his muscles bulging, his head held high as he races across the prairie. That's a wild horse. Never been broken to a saddle, doesn't know the feel of a harness, and in that state, that horse is absolutely worthless. He may be beautiful to look at, but he is not worth a dime. Nobody has ever rode him. Nobody has ever worked him. He has no utility, no usefulness at all, except to say, isn't that a beautiful horse? That's all of us in our sin nature. Until we are broken, church, until we are broken to meekness and humility, we have only limited value for God. Unless we are tamed of our wild, unproductive nature that we're born with, and learn how to be broken to humility and meekness before God, we're only of limited value to God. So consider this word humility again. Think, if I use humility or meekness, it's all the same thing. The average person interprets humility or meekness as being a weak person. And that's absolutely unreasonable, church. But I've got to sell you on the idea. My goal this morning is to persuade you with all my heart and soul that humility is not weakness, it is strength under control. Well, let me come at you with a different illustration. How many of you have actually seen the huge Clydesdale horses that pull a certain kind of wagon? You have. Now, there are some huge draft horses like the Percheron, the Clydesdale, the Belgian, and there's a whole variety of these huge horses that can weigh up to a ton, 17 to 19 hands tall. They have feet so huge that you can't even imagine being stepped on by one. These horses are called gentle giants. A child can walk through their legs and under their belt, and they won't move. You can set a child on their back when they're roped to the harness and they're not going to move. They call them the gentle giants of all time. Why are they so useful? Why can these huge beasts pull tremendous loads if called upon? They have powerful muscle. It's because they're tame. They're gentle. They're meek. They're roped to the harness. That's what God wants all of His children. God wants you to be of a disposition that He can use you for the advancement of His kingdom. But if you're untamed and wild and your character's flying off in 50 different directions, you may be almost unusable for God. Now the promise here is, blessed are the meek. Blessed are the humble, for they shall inherit the earth. I can't even wrap my mind around that promise, can you? Think about it. Blessed are the humble, they will inherit the earth. I don't know of a promise in the Bible that's more significant than that. Psalm 37 verses 10 and 11 is beautiful. It incorporates the word, but the meek shall inherit the earth and shall delight themselves in the abundance of peace. So Jesus was just repeating something that had been repeated centuries earlier by Jesus, correction, by David and all kinds of other illustrious saints, when they said the meek, the humble, will inherit the earth. What a promise. Now we all know, church, and I want you to think about this, because some of you come from different religious backgrounds. Heaven is not the final destination of the saints. Did you know that? When someone dies and we say, oh, they went to heaven, if they died in Christ and were saved as a redeemed soul, in truth, their soul goes to be with Jesus in paradise. That's a Bible teaching. It's a whole study into itself. But they are not just going to go up to heaven forever, because the Bible teaches that the meek will inherit the earth. Jesus teaches us, taught us to pray, "Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven." So we pray every time we say the Lord's Prayer, we're praying that the kingdom will come to earth. One day Jesus will bring the saints with Him, all the redeemed of the ages, and their incorporeal spirit body will be joined with a newly resurrected physical body to inherit the earth. So it's not a promise of pie in the sky here. When the Bible says the meek will inherit the earth, it's really, really important to know that the meek will inherit the earth because the earth was made for the kingdom. That's why God made this earth. When God put Adam and Eve in the earth, they could have lived forever. God did not create the earth for people to live and die. He created the earth for the kingdom of God, and one day this whole earth will be filled with the glory of the kingdom of God. And Jesus will be on the throne of that kingdom. So how then do we as a body learn how to be humble or meek or gentle? How in the world can we do that? Well, we must learn how to control our frustrations and the flashpoints in life that precipitate anger and cause us to come unglued. Remember, humility, strength, under control. How many think it's easy to fulfill the third beatitude? I know Dolores is listening. Strength under control. Having your emotions under control does not imply or mean that you are a pushover or someone to use as a doormat. It does not mean that you are just a sidewalk for someone to walk on. It simply means that you do not overreact nor allow your emotions to suddenly conquer who you are. Are you with me?
Yes.
Thank you.
Amen.
Now, are there blessings attached to the third beatitude? There is. Blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. But how many of you know that that's only the beginning of the blessing that flows from this beatitude? Your life, beginning today, can be so much better if you will let the words of Jesus, through the power of the Holy Spirit, transform your inner thought about how to live your life. So, as we look at this beatitude, I want you to think about the importance of the word that Jesus has given us. Now, my first inclination was to read all the verses in the Bible that promote humility and or meekness. And there are a lot of those verses. But I thought it will be unnecessary for me to use a lot of time to recite all verses that you already know if you've read the Bible. So I thought, well, let's shift gears and go another way. Let's just itemize all the different ways that this beatitude can help you live your life in this present world. So that when you leave here today, you will be able to say, I came to church today and I have learned a quality out of the third beatitude that I'm going to seek to practice in my daily walk in life. So number one, the beatitude, the third beatitude, teaching us to be humble, will help us defuse personal conflicts. Humility defuses and de-escalates anger. You will find that some people are emotional time bombs, ready to explode at a moment's notice. These are the people that desperately need to learn how to live in humility. Meekness is a strong antidote for anger. Or I could have said humility. Consider how a humble and gentle spirit
can defuse, de-escalate anger. Let me read from Proverbs 15, verse 1. The Bible says, Proverbs 15, 1, a soft
answer turneth away wrath.
Turneth away wrath. But grievous words stir up anger. You know that to be true, don't you? When we learn how to diffuse anger, it will be clear to see the blessing that will come from the work of Jesus. Blessed are the meek, the humble, for they shall inherit the earth. Now, many of us do not realize, church, that your brain is a rather complex, and it's a very wonderful part of who we are. There are mirror neurons in the brain that cause you to sympathize or to mimic back what other people you are talking to are feeling. Are you aware of that? If someone who is angry confronts you, the normal response is to become angry too. If someone raises their voice at you, you're tempted to escalate yours to a new decibel. You will soon find that both persons are in an argument and they're drifting toward a shouting match. Now, if we are with someone that's depressed and we're listening to them long enough, we may also become depressed. If we are with someone that's happy and jolly and looking at the world in a positive way, we're likely to become happy and jolly also, because our brain is programmed to mirror the response of the people around us. See, we're not born into this world with a normal ability to control our emotions, church. These are learned responses. Your children are not born knowing how to control anger. You agree with it? It's just part of our nature to lose our cool. Now, here's something that you need to remember, and it'll help you through life. When someone around you becomes angry, remember, when other people raise their voice, you lower yours. It will immediately de-escalate the argument. A soft answer turneth away wrath. It's learning how to keep strength under control. Ecclesiastes 10, verse 4 says it this way. If the spirit of a ruler, an authority figure in your life, rise up against thee, leave not thy place, for yielding pacifies great offenses. Let me sort of reinterpret that for you if I have the liberty to do so. If your boss becomes angry at you, boys and girls, if your parents become miffed at you, wives, if your husband becomes angry, husbands, if your wife becomes angry, don't immediately go into an emotional meltdown. Blessed are the meek. Keep your spirit under control. Keep your emotions under control. Calm down, speak with a soft voice, and it immediately begins the process of de-escalation of any kind.